All right, this is fluid power for tool design, sort of the high points of fluid power, kind of the basics to make you conversant in fluid power. All right, so there are a lot of advantages for fluid power. You can separate the power source from the actuator itself. You can get nice, smooth motion, overload protection, a variety of motions available, and it's fairly economical. All right, so the idea behind fluid power is you already understand this idea of mechanical advantage. If we have, say, a pretty classic explanation of a lever, okay, so you can apply a smaller force on one side and multiply that force by increasing the distance away from some pivot point. Okay, so kind of the same general idea applies for fluid power. It's kind of like a liquid lever. But this is sort of how it's laid out, okay? So you have a force on this side across a small cross-sectional area. So you apply this force to this cross-sectional area, and to find the pressure that results from that is just F equals PA is the equation that we're going to be using. So to solve for the pressure, we would just take and rearrange our F equals PA equation to give us P, or pressure, is force divided by area. And even if you have forgotten this, if you find yourself taking a test or something and you can't figure out what the pressure is supposed to be, just remember the units of pressure are, well, the U.S. customary units of pressure. You can use pounds per square inch, or PSI. That will give you this equation. You've got some unit of force over some cross-sectional area. Okay, so here we're pushing down with some force, building up pressure with this cross-sectional area. On this side, we have if this whole system is in equilibrium, then we have a larger area on this side, and we'll have a larger resulting force. Because if we think about, so here on this side, let's say we have 1,000 pounds and 1 square inch on this side. All right, so we have 1,000 pounds divided by 1 square inch gives us 1,000 pounds per square inch, or 1,000 PSI. That pressure travels across this tube to this this cylinder, and over here we have an equal pressure, all right, because the pressure is allowed to equalize across these two cylinders. So here we have 1,000 pounds per square inch of pressure. And if we want to figure out how much force would be exerted to balance this system out, then we use our F equals PA again. The P doesn't change on this side. The pressure is 1,000, but we multiply that 1,000 pounds per square inch times this larger cross-sectional area. Let's say this is 10 square inches on this side. And so we have 10 times as much force, or 10,000 pounds on this side, to balance it out. Okay, so we've multiplied the force. Now, what we give up on that is the distance that this cylinder has to travel on this side. Okay, so if we push in on this and it moves 1 inch, we'll get basically a tenth of that on this other side. So we give that back up is the amount of distance that we actually move. So this is kind of the underlying rule. And it's really not a whole lot of math to remember. Now, of course, you will have to be able to calculate a cross-sectional area, generally given a diameter, so be prepared to do that. Okay, so we called this lecture fluid power, but we didn't really talk about what a fluid is, and I need to probably clear that up. So fluids can be gases or they can be liquids. So generally we'll talk about pneumatics being a gas system that's generally based on just strictly compressed air. And also liquid systems, which consist of hydraulic fluid, moving hydraulic fluid. So there are some important differences between pneumatics and hydraulics, two different types of fluid power systems. And there's also vacuum. So we'll talk about a vacuum system here in just a second. But first of all, the really important difference between pneumatics and hydraulics is this idea of compressibility. Okay, so gases you can take and compress them many times over. You can take a gas and squeeze lots and lots of gas into a compressed air tank, for instance. With hydraulics, however, these liquids are not compressible for all intents and purposes. They you have, you know, a few examples of liquids that are very slightly compressible. But as a rule, you can just think of them as being incompressible, and you cannot take and squeeze, you know, 2 gallons of milk into a gallon jug. It just doesn't happen. You can take and squeeze, lots and lots of air into a tank like that, but you can't squeeze more liquid. So think about that in terms of storing energy. You may know springs. You can store an awful lot of energy in them, and pneumatic systems are a lot like springs, because you can take a pneumatic cylinder and just squish it, and if you have enough force, you can compress that gas even more. So they're not incompressible. They compress a lot. They're springy, and you can store energy in that compressed fluid, in that compressed gas, but you can't do that with hydraulics. You cannot compress hydraulics, and it's just like squeezing on a brick. You don't get any energy back out after squeezing and compressing a brick. You only do that when you squeeze or compress a spring. And we'll unpack that a little bit more later. Something important to know about is vacuum. So there are vacuum systems, especially for work holding, that we've already seen this semester. And we've said that you have a limited amount of pressure available, working pressure available from a vacuum. It's based strictly on atmospheric pressure. So as sort of a thought experiment and a way of understanding what you can and can't do with vacuum is this idea of a barometer. So if you have this trough filled with mercury and you lay down in that mercury a glass tube and you allow it to completely fill up with mercury so there's no air at all in there, and then you lift that tube up out of the mercury. If that tube is longer than about 30 inches long, you'll have a space up here at the top. And it doesn't matter if this tube is 30 inches or 60 inches long, the mercury will never rise higher in that tube, any higher than the atmospheric pressure will push it up into that tube. And that's why you see atmospheric pressure a lot of times given in inches of mercury, okay? So it's generally, somewhere around 30 inches of mercury. So that's important, to understand that works out to about 14 pounds per square inch of pressure that's available to do any kind of work holding. But it's also important to understand that if you had a system and you're trying to pull a liquid up into that system, and, well, let's just say that you have a mercury-based hydraulic system, just for fun, okay? It might be something you find on YouTube, okay? But let's say you're trying to pull that mercury, that liquid, up out of this tank. If you pull too quickly, or if you restrict this, and you're pulling with enough pressure, then you'll actually open up cavities in here. This, in fact, it's called cavitation. You'll wind up pulling voids into your system. You'll wind up with vacuum pockets, which can collapse and then cause damage. All right, so you can only lift a liquid so far without by pulling on it with vacuum, by actually pulling a liquid. And that's going to be important later on, as we'll see. All right, so if we're talking about pneumatic systems and we've got gases, these gases are going to follow a few rules, and I'm not going to beat these to death. I just want you to kind of remember them. There's Boyle's Law, and this one makes perfect sense, and that is that as you decrease the volume of a cylinder that's holding some kind of gas, that the pressure will rise. By the same token, you've got a relationship between the volume and the temperature of the gas. You can see a lot of that happening in the ideal gas law. Okay, so this thing can be rearranged in different ways, and I'm not going to beat that to death, but no such a thing exists, and it's a nice way to relate pressure, volume, and temperature with the amount of substance and this ideal gas constant. All right, so liquids, on the other hand, have really different types of properties. Okay, if you tried to do a Boyle's Law experiment with liquid, it's not going to work out the same way. Okay, so completely different type of system. Essentially, for all intents and purposes, a hydraulic system, you're dealing with a medium that is incompressible. Now, I will say sometimes you see behavior that makes it look like the hydraulic fluid is compressible, but sometimes what you're seeing is expansion of hoses and tubes. Metal tubes will expand if they're pressurized. You know, length of hose will expand if it's pressurized. And you can also wind up with things like air entrained in a system that will give sort of a spongy action to the system. All right, but in general, you want to think of these liquids as being incompressible. You should know about this thing called the specific gravity. That's essentially how you can find the weight of liquids, and it's based on their relationship or the ratio of them to the density of water. Okay, so the density of a substance, so for instance, the density of water over the density of water would give you one. So water has a specific gravity of one. And that's, of course, pure water. Salt water would be slightly higher. Hydraulic oil, for instance, not much, but 85% or so as heavy as water. So it has a specific gravity of 0.85. Mercury, as you can see, very much heavier. All right, so we'll look a little bit about liquids in motion. First of all, the amount of liquid that's flowing, the volume of liquid, is the product of the velocity of the liquid moving through the system in something like inches per minute or inches per second, multiplied by the cross-sectional area. Okay, so if we have a system like this where the cross-sectional area reduces, the velocity is going to maintain, it's going to stay constant. The quantity of fluid flowing through is going to remain constant. That means that the fluid's going to have to accelerate as it goes into a smaller cross-sectional area. It's important to know the difference between laminar and turbulent flow. There are some really excellent videos out there. This one is pretty amazing because they take and unstir some water. Oh, it's actually glycerin. They take and unstir some colorant in this glycerin. These two illustrations of laminar flow and turbulent flow, I think the guy, there's a good Smarter Every Day video on laminar versus turbulent flow. And there's an important number to know about called the Reynolds number that's used to kind of characterize where this is going to happen. Okay, so if you have a low Reynolds number, you wind up with laminar flow. If you get higher Reynolds numbers, you get turbulent flow. This is something about where the Reynolds number comes from, but for this class, we are going to skip right over that. You should remember something about Bernoulli's principle, okay, and that is if you have a system like this with a flowing fluid through here, this is going to be the higher pressure side, this is going to be the lower pressure side, and sometimes that's a little bit counterintuitive. But if you're ever stuck on the interstate, you'll see this happening. You know, you may have lots and lots of lanes open, but if there's an accident blocking off three or four of the lanes, this is where the high pressure is. The cars back up on this side. By the time you get to the restriction, when you're actually at the place where the accident happened, this is where everybody accelerates. Okay, and so you have a pressure drop on this side. All right, understand the difference between static pressure and dynamic pressure. And I think a real nice, easy way to understand that is understanding how a pitot tube works. Okay, so the dynamic pressure, this is the pressure that you're going to feel if you are on the interstate and you roll the window down, you stick your hand out the window. Okay, that air impinging on your hand has a pressure, and that can be measured. This is a device called a pitot tube. They're sometimes used to measure airspeed on airplanes and measure wind speed and things. We used to use them for when we were testing gas appliance vents and things. We do wind tests, and we would test the wind speed with a pitot tube. And the way that you do that is you have this tube is actually a coaxial tube, and the inside of the tube has a port that's open on the end down here. And that tube feels two pressures. Number one, picture this as not being a flowing fluid. Just think of it as being a tank being pressurized. And you could see that this inside tube would feel that pressure. That would be the static pressure if this were just a tank. This other tube, it also feels static pressure. So you see here the static pressure would enter and it would move this gauge up, thinking of this just as a tank first of all. That's the static pressure. The other component to this is the dynamic pressure, and that's the pressure that you feel when you stick your hand out the window on the interstate. That's going to be the pressure impinging on this end of the tube. And so this gauge feels both. It feels the static pressure and the dynamic pressure. And if you want to know strictly the dynamic pressure, and that's going to be proportional to the speed that this liquid is flowing or fluid is flowing, then you subtract this static pressure from the total pressure, and that will give you the dynamic pressure. And in fact, a lot of gauges have like a low pressure port on the side, and you just reconnect this side of the pitot tube to the low pressure and it will subtract it out, and it will directly read the dynamic pressure. Those are pretty interesting. You know, there have been pretty famous airline accidents that have involved pitot tubes malfunctioning, so they're pretty good to understand those things. All right, we're going to talk about some of these components. First of all, the fluid in a hydraulic fluid, it functions to transmit power, but it also does the job of heat transfer, so you can have cooling heat exchangers that will cool the system down, and it also nicely operates as a lubricant. Viscosity is important to understand. Viscosity is the sort of internal friction of a liquid that prevents it, that wants it to not move. So a high viscosity is going to be a liquid like honey, a liquid that flows slowly, and a low viscosity is one that flows easily. All right, so first of all, if we have a pneumatic system, we're going to take, generally this begins by taking air and squeezing it into a tank or an accumulator. And there are lots of different ways of doing that. We're not going to go over all of the different types of compressors. Like I said, we're just hitting the high points today. But essentially what you're doing is squeezing gas, generally just air, into a tank or an accumulator. Now, a tank, as far as hydraulic systems are concerned, are generally not pressurized at all. They are generally just a tank to hold a liquid. Now, a hydraulic pump is not doing the job of storing energy into the liquid, okay? It is moving the liquid. It is positively displacing the liquid from one place to another. Now, this gear pump is a pretty common way of doing that, and a pretty good animation on Wikipedia. But you can see here the fluid comes in, and it's just moved. So you're positively displacing this fluid. So it has to go somewhere. So if you got 1 cubic inch of fluid coming in here, there's got to be a cubic inch of space over here for it to flow into. And that may be a moving cylinder or a hydraulic motor or something. But that fluid has to go somewhere. Interestingly, you see the bubbles in here. You can wind up on this side. This is the low pressure side, like I talked about earlier. If this gets restricted, you can wind up with cavitation. You can wind up with bubbles in here that will then come in and collapse and cause all kinds of problems. So you don't want to draw too much of a vacuum on this. You don't want to exceed whatever the atmospheric pressure is on this side. All right, so you may be asking, if that fluid has to go somewhere, you run a hydraulic system, you turn the thing on, you hear the motor running, and you just cycle a valve. This may be on like a tractor or a wood splitter, firewood splitter, or you know, some kind of equipment, you hear the hydraulic motor running and you hear the pump running, but you may not see the cylinder may not be moving. So where does that pressure go? Where does that, and more importantly, you know, where does that fluid go? And how does it maintain that pressure? And this is how that works. Okay, here's a diagram showing, first of all, the tank. So here's our just an open shell of metal that has hydraulic oil in it. And we have a filter, and then we have a pump. So that pump is pulling that hydraulic fluid up out of the tank, filtering it, and pushing it in this direction. That means it has to be going somewhere. Now, in this case, it's going up and it's actually moving this cylinder forward, okay? And we'll talk about what's going on in here. But what about when that cylinder finally extends fully, okay? Once it's done that, then let's just shut this off, okay? We'll turn a valve off and shut this end of the unit off, because I haven't talked about what's going on with this directional control valve yet. So let's just turn this off. So we have a valve here, and we just close this system off. Here's what's going to happen. The pressure is going to build up on this pressure relief valve. And when you see these little symbols like this with the arrows, they're trying to show you visually how that thing works, okay? And what you see here is this is the main flow of the liquid. It gets to this valve here. And you see that what's happening is it stops there. It's been shut off. Well, as you can see, there's something that extends beyond this. So there's actually a little line that leads from the main line, and it's pushing against this whole box, okay? And as it pushes on that box, you can see what it's going to want to do is line these arrows back up with this line here, and that will allow the fluid to drain. But there's something preventing it from, you know, to adding some pressure behind it, and that's this spring with a line through, with an arrow through it. Now, you know from Tech 1811 that a squiggly line, like a resistance with an arrow through it, means that's variable. So this is a pressure relief valve, and if we can tighten that valve and increase the pressure. Okay, so this is how you maintain something like 500 PSI or 1,000 PSI in this system, in this line, without the fluid actually going downstream, because it's going out to the tank, but it's going through the pressure relief valve, which means that it has to build up something like 5,000 or 500 PSI or more, maybe 1,000, maybe 5,000 PSI before it is allowed to vent. But it will vent when it reaches that amount. So there's never fluid that's actually being compressed. It's being pressurized, but it's not actually getting smaller. It's always going somewhere. All right, so that was kind of a sad explanation of a pressure relief valve. There's a really good video here that will explain that a whole lot better. But that's how you maintain the pressure in a hydraulic system as opposed to a pneumatic system. See, a pneumatic system, you can go ahead and pressurize the tank. You can shut off the electricity altogether and still run that system for a while until you run out of pressure. Not the same thing with hydraulics. With hydraulics, you shut the power off. If there's not some other pressure source, like what we'll talk about in a minute, then that system is DOA. All right, so one of the main ways that you get useful energy out of a useful motion out of a hydraulic system is with a cylinder. Okay, it's not the only way. There are hydraulic motors and there are other devices, but with a hydraulic cylinder is kind of the easiest one to explain, probably the most familiar to people. All right, so let's look at this hydraulic cylinder here. Okay, hydraulic cylinders have two ends. This is called the rod end out here where the rod is, and the other side of this is called the cap end. Now, keeping in mind what we learned earlier, if we were to put 1,000 PSI into this line right here, what do you expect to happen? Okay, now, normally if I ask a live class what would happen, I'll get two answers, okay? One group of students will say nothing will happen, it will sit still, because it looks like that would put it in equilibrium, and the other group says, no, the rod will extend, okay? And the second group in this case is correct. All right. And you actually have all of the tools to know why that would happen at this point. Okay. And it all boils down to this F equals PA. So the amount of force acting in this direction is going to be different from the force acting in the other direction. So the force acting to extend this is F equals PA, but the A is this full cylinder. Okay, the full end of the cylinder down here. This is the cap end, and it's the exact, it has the area of the diameter of the inside of the cylinder. The other force, the force acting to push it in the other direction, as if, when the fluid flows through this side, is F equals PA as well. P is constant on both sides, but the area is less, okay? And so you wind up with a net force in the extend direction. Now, of course, you don't really do this in real life, okay? In real life, you have two separate pressures on either side. And in fact, a lot of times, pressure 2 over here can even be just atmospheric pressure, because you may have this draining to a tank or something like that. On the other hand, sometimes it's just, it's a different pressure. So just keep that in mind. If pressure 2 down here, if we're extending the rod, in other words, we're pressurizing port 1, the cap end of the cylinder, then the force that's trying to extend this is F equals PA, okay? Pressure times whatever the cross-sectional area is. If we have something greater than atmospheric pressure on the pressure 2 side, for instance, down here at 500 psi, then we just calculate it twice. We calculate the force acting in this direction, and we subtract from it the force acting in the opposite direction. Also, keep in mind that area on this side, the area on the rod end, is always going to be this annular area. Okay, you have to subtract out the area of the rod to find out the force in the retract direction. So a rod like this is always have more force available to extend the rod than you have to retract the rod. All right, so this diagram looks a little bit difficult to understand. But keep in mind, this is for high school students, though, okay? So all you really need is a little fundamental understanding of what these diagrams mean, and pretty soon you'll be able to decode what's going on in this circuit, okay? So let's just take some of these apart real quickly. Pressure gauges, that one's pretty easy to understand. This is a pressure switch. So you see here, we have that same symbol of the spring, which means that as you add pressure to this thing, it's going to compress that spring, and then it's going to kill. This is actually showing it's in the that this side there would be two different ports on this pressure switch, and so you could have one that was normally closed that would allow you to have like a green light that would say that the system is that it's working at a safe pressure. And then you might have an alarm go off when this pressure reaches a certain height, okay? This is just a ball valve to vent pressure out. So this lets us know if there's an adequate amount of pressure or if there's too much pressure in the system, depending on how we wire this up. All right, this is a pressure relief valve. And in this case, this is a pneumatic system. And so they're not using this to actually control the downstream pressure. This is preventing too much pressure from building up in the system. So if we have this tank and we're pressurizing the system here, this is the compressor pumping air into this system. If it gets to be too much, you see, this little pilot will come around. It will push this valve against the spring. In this case, it's not adjustable. And it will allow the compressed air to vent to the atmosphere. So similar to the pressure relief valve that we saw earlier, but not exactly the same thing. This that you see in here is a check valve, okay? And the way to think about that is like a ball in a funnel, okay? So if this were a funnel and you have a ball in there, you would be able to blow air in this direction. Air could flow in this direction, but if we tried to reverse that, you see the air would push against the ball and it would close up against the funnel and could not flow in the other direction. All right, these are directional control valves. Really, a lot of times, sort of the bread and butter of a hydraulic or pneumatic system. This is how you get control over the different actuators like motors and pumps. Okay, hydraulic motors and not pumps, sorry, cylinders. So motors and cylinders, hydraulic motors, hydraulic cylinders, or pneumatic cylinders. This is how you control which, you know, whether a cylinder is extending or retracting or staying put. And these are some really good videos on this. Okay, so I'm going to hit the high points, and if it still doesn't make sense to you, I highly recommend these videos. They are very good. I'm not going to just sit here and replay them for you though, but they're in the notes with there's a link to the notes, or I'll put a link in the video description. All right, so this is really what's going on. This is a spool valve. And all those directional control valves, well, they tend to be spool valves. And they're called spool valves because, if I just close this outside, you see this inside piece in here is called the spool. And you can see it actually looks like spools of thread, okay? And what happens inside this valve is when we actuate this lever, all it's really doing is moving the spool left and right, okay? So it's just moving the spool in and out, left and right. So that's really the moving part. Now, let me turn that block back on, and I'll show you around what all's going on here, okay? All right, so you see these different holes in this block. These are drilled and tapped holes, and we attach fittings to them, all right? This one right here is going to be the pressure. So this one a lot of times is labeled P because this is the pressure port. So we have our pump or our pressurized system is starting here, and it's moving. And let me do this. Let me turn this off. There we go. Okay. So pressure is flowing into here, and that pressure, the fluid that flows into this port, is able to move around this spool valve. Okay. You see, it has a gap in it. Now it can't go. It can't go left and right because there are these O-rings blocking it off, but it can go around this passage, and it can pressurize this side. Okay, so this side is receiving pressure now. These two sides are generally called A and B. This port A and B. Think about the two ends of a cylinder. It might be that if you want to extend a cylinder, you call the cap end of that cylinder the A side, and the other, the rod end, would be the B side. All right, so this would be pressurizing maybe the B side, and you can see what's happening to the other side, like the A side. In that case, we've got fluid flowing in here, and that fluid is now routed around the spool and goes out this side. Generally, this side and this, the two outsides, go to the tank. So you have a hose or a line that connects these to the tank, and they'll be labeled T. All right. So let me move the cylinder now to the other position. All right, so now with the cylinder in that other position, with the spool shifted, P, the pressure side, now goes to A. So this would extend the cylinder, and the other side of the cylinder, the B side, in this case maybe the cap end, or the rod end, would now come to here and drain out and go to the tank. All right, so those are the two different positions that this valve could be in. It's either going to be pressurizing A or it's going to be pressurizing B. And, of course, the one that I showed you just used a hand lever to do that. A lot of control valves use solenoids to actually energize and push that valve back and forth, to push the valve in one direction, and then a spring can return it to the other direction, or a solenoid on the other side will return it. But in general, those valves, they can either be operated manually or with solenoids. Here are another couple of examples. This is this one has a pilot on it, so it actually has a valve that treats the spool as if the spool itself were a hydraulic cylinder. So you kind of multiply the action there. But let me show you what's going on with these diagrams. And those, like I said, these other videos spend a lot more time on this and are much better than what you're going to get here. So I'm going to recommend that you watch that. All right, so here's our system so far. We've got the tank, we've got the pump, we've got a a gauge telling us how much pressure is in the system. We have our pressure relief valve that's controlling the pressure, that's controlling the maximum pressure that will build up. Okay. All right, so here we have the pressure port on our directional control valve. Okay, and we just looked at that. This is basically a spool valve, and this spool valve has three positions. All right, and it has four ways. So we have one is the P, A, B, and T. Those are the four ways, and it's a three-position four-way valve. So in this first position, we can see on this diagram that pressure is going to the A side. And of course, here we're using that to drive this cylinder and extend the cylinder. B, we are draining. Okay, so B is draining to the tank through that same valve. Now notice what happens in the center position. When we move this valve to the center position, P just gets in here and it gets blocked off and it can't go anywhere. So in this position, the pressure would build up to its maximum allowed by the pressure relief valve. The cylinder would not be able to move forward or backward because it's blocked off here. Okay. Now let me just, it's probably too early to point this out, but let me just say, let's just take a look at this and let's get some snips and cut this hydraulic hose. All right. So let's cut this hydraulic hose. Can this cylinder extend out? Could we yank on this cylinder and pull it out? The answer would be yes, we could do that because we could pull a vacuum on this side. This side, if it leaks out and there's nothing stopping this fluid from flowing out, remember, we take and cut a hole in this, cut that line, we could extend this cylinder because we're able to pull a vacuum on this. The only thing preventing that cylinder from pulling forward is atmospheric pressure. Okay, so that can actually result in pretty dangerous circumstances if we don't understand that. All right, but in this case, we won't have the rod extend out if we're in the center position, okay, because it will be blocked off. Pressure is building up to its maximum. Nothing is draining to the tank. A and B are blocked off, so the cylinder cannot move left or right. Doesn't matter what atmospheric pressure is. It was locked in there rigidly. Now in the third position, in this position, pressure is going to the B side and the A side is draining to the tank. So in this position, the rod on the cylinder would retract. Okay, so it's very important that you can read these and evaluate these because you're going to have a series of test questions that are going to ask you about what would happen if this or that happened with this particular spool valve. This is an actual solenoid valve down in the shop, and I thought I would show you kind of what they look like in real life and how P, A, B, and T work out and how they look. Okay, here you see the spool valve that's showing you the different positions, and the solenoids push. So if solenoid A were energized, you would have this condition. If solenoid B were energized, you would have this condition. And this one is spring return, which it doesn't show on here. But you would be in this center position if neither solenoid were energized. And these are the actual ports that you see here. So this is P, this is B, this is A, and both of these are T. All right, so then in a pneumatic system, there is this device called a regulator. It works very similar to a pressure relief valve in a hydraulic system, and it's just going to control the downstream pressure. And of course you can see here we've got the adjustable symbol, so that means this can be adjusted, and you increase the pressure by tightening the spring. When you tighten down on a regulator, you're going to be increasing the pressure downstream. Then there are accumulators. So you can use the term accumulator for a tank in a pneumatic system, but in a hydraulic system, an accumulator is a it's a compressible feature, okay? So it is one way to actually add a compressible nature to a hydraulic system, all right? So since the fluid itself can't compress, you can add a thing called an accumulator that will give you that option, that will allow it to behave as if it's being compressed. So these are often things like gas that's under extremely high pressure that then gets pressurized by the oil and allows some movement in between here. So it they're used kind of like you would use a capacitor. Okay, so they take some energy and then they'll give it back like a spring would. All right, so capacitors are really kind of like electronic springs. An accumulator is a spring in that same sort of way. So you can use these when you need to return out hydraulic fluid quickly, maybe at a faster rate than your pump would allow, so you can have sort of a burst of flow. And they can also be used to hold and maintain pressure when you've released a section of the system from the pump. All right, these are flow control fittings. So this is what I was going to talk about earlier. In this system, if we didn't have this device in here, we could take and you could yank, you could pull on this cylinder, and there would be nothing to stop it from pulling because you could pull a vacuum on the backside here. Even if you're, you know, if you're filling it up, if it's pressurized, but you exceed that flow rate by pulling on this. Maybe you have a condition like this where you're lifting, you're pushing with this cylinder, this heavy load, and once that load reaches this peak here and starts to go the other direction, this load's going to start pulling on this cylinder. All right, that's when you need to have a setup something like this. This is a metering out circuit, okay? And what's happening here is we have this valve in here, this flow control valve. And on a pneumatic system, you can get them that look kind of like this. They're a little bit more robust, and they look a little different on a hydraulic system. But in this case, we want to prevent that sort of condition, when the yanking of this cylinder. And so what we have here is this flow control system. Now, you already understand some of what's going on here, all right? If we were to reverse this flow and push fluid in this direction, there would be nothing restricting it because it's going to flow through this check valve freely. This is our little funnel and ball system here. So it will flow through here and it would fill this up just as rapidly as the fluid's being supplied. But in this condition, like we have here, when we're pressurizing the cap end of the cylinder, it will only go as fast as this flow control valve allows it to. Okay? This is actually controlling the extend speed, because we can take and change this restriction. This is a restriction with an arrow through it. That means this is adjustable. So we can adjust this, the rate that this rod extends, regardless of the pressure that's building up in here. So we can actually stop this thing from flowing if we shut this valve all the way off. And we can build up as much pressure as you want without damaging the system, and it's not going to go anywhere. And then we can open that up very slowly and allow this cylinder to extend at a very slow rate. And that's what's giving us control. This is a metering out circuit. Now, as soon as we reverse this, there's no control over it. So this rod will retract much faster than it is extending. All right, this is just another look at a directional control valve. This slide's maybe a little bit out of sequence, but here you see we have a two-position five-way valve, because we have five different ways that this material can flow. And you see that it's solenoid actuated, and it has these two separate positions depending on how it's actuated. All right, so this is one of the main types of problems that you'll need to be able to solve. And really, the only equation that you need is force equals pressure times area. But you've got to remember, you might have two pressures. You might have to use this thing twice, because you might have a pressure on one side, a different area on one side that may be acting against the other direction. Okay, so you've got to keep your forces, your pressures, and your areas separate. But I promise you, that's really the only equation you know. But of course, you'll have to be able to calculate area. All right, so here is probably the simplest example that you would want to see. On this one, we have a 1,000 psi fluid in here. So our pressure, our force divided by square inches, our pressure is 1,000 psi at the cap end. We have a 2-inch diameter cylinder. The rod is stopped by a concrete wall so that there's no motion. We want to find the force exerted by the rod onto the wall. Okay. Well, it's not 2,000. All right, I'll just tell you that. Because this is the diameter of the cylinder, not the area of the cylinder. But it's almost that easy. Okay, since it's a 2-inch diameter, that means it has a 1-inch radius. And so the area, pi times the radius squared, is just going to be pi times 1 squared, which is pi times 1, which is pi. All right, so the area of the cylinder is pi square inches. Multiply that times 1,000 pounds over square inches, and we'll be left with 3.14 thousand pounds, or 3,140 pounds of pressure. All right, so that's as simple a one as you can expect. The most complex one that you could expect would just be one that had a pressure on the low pressure side. All right, so that's all we're going to talk about in the lecture. We will have, for the labs, there will be some different types of circuits. We'll talk about some of those. And a lot of the questions, though, will deal with understanding what's going on with these directional control valves, okay? So be able to understand the logic of what's happening with those directional control valves.